interview was conducted with Professor Sam Postlethwait for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Tuesday, October 23rd, 2007, at his residence in West Lafayette. This is part two of the interview. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Library. We'll pick up on the auditorial. Okay.
Yes.
Some closing things, comments on that. Go ahead.
In those days, people were kind of looking for automatic everything. And it was very important to me that we were not talking about automatic instruction. We were talking about tutorial instruction, in which we were using an audio tape and with the instructor tutoring a student through a sequence of learning events to accomplish certain things that they had specified. So that this is quite different in just delivering information. A good instructional audio tutorial program was one that involved the student in every step of the process, with lots of questions and involvement of the student helping to find the answers to those questions, rather than automatically delivering information to them. Now, during these early years, in the 60s through to the 70s, this was one of the problems that I had, because lots of teachers would read about it, and then they would think, oh, here's a way that I can get out of the classroom and still get my work done. I was very, very adamant about, no, please don't use the audio tape in your course and call it audio tutorial unless you're going to tutor students through a sequence of learning events. And those events clearly identified, and that you know what is expected of the student, and the student knows what is expected of them, which in those days was quite a contrary perception of an instructional design.
In the 60s and 70s, yes. How was that?
Up to that time, generally speaking, we saw a professor as a source of information, which he was delivering, and the student was trying to find out what it was that they ought to know from what he delivered. And now, quite contrary to that, we were specifying with a set of objectives precisely what we expected the student to accomplish. And then, through tutoring with the audio tape and allowing that student the privilege of participating as they needed to, based on their background and already knowing something about the subject, to proceed as a participant in the learning setting. Yes. And you see that? Or at least to me, it's a whole different perception of instructional design. Deliverance of information was well taken care of when people begin to write books, and it's easy to deliver a book, and the information is there just as well. But there's a whole lot more to a good instructional design than delivering the information here. And in fact, with the distance learning, I contend that was distance learning when somebody invented textbooks and they started passing these along, and you were not associated with the instructor who wrote the book. So that is distance learning.
Sure.
But again,
who put the things on the tapes? Did you do those, or did you?
Oh, I did those, and you see, this I thought it was very important that I hopefully I was thinking that I had more skill I knew more what, and I knew what I was trying to accomplish,
sure.
And I was talking.
As the instructor.
As the instructor.
Right.
So, again, that is different than just delivering information by audio
right.
tape, which some of the people who started into audio tutorial thought it was auto tutorial, and this was difficult for me to teach them the difference, and there is a difference.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
And then what after is it does it exist today? What's the status?
Obviously, the computer now could do so many more things, and as the computer came along, what an excellent tool it became, because it could not only store audio tape, instead of having to have movies like I had with each student had access to a movie projector in their booth here, and of course each student had printed pictures or whatever. With a computer, you can make the same sort of an instructional thing, but add to it movies, talks, a whole, it's unlimited now in your capacity. The limitation becomes a capacity of the instructor to design something that is useful here. Now, unfortunately, the people in agronomy here have done just that, and they have a wonderful, literally wonderful, and I think the very, very top of instructional design here at Purdue, not very well known by anybody here, but it is functioning very, very well. And it was an outgrowth of the audio tutorial.
Good. That's nice.
There are probably some places that are still doing audio tutorial, but I never thought of the tape recorder as the basic part of the instructional design. It helped me be available to students.
Was the vehicle.
Yes, as a vehicle.
Right.
And so it was so natural to go on to the computer.
What about, it was international, are there any other places in the world that you know they're still, you've been to Australia, do you know people that are you in contact with any of them, do you think some of them are still using it, or have they?
They did for years and years,
mm-hmm.
And they, I haven't had contact with people in Australia for several years now, but of course they did this in Puerto Rico and in Japan and in Russia and in France and Northern Ireland and Southern Ireland and South Africa.
International.
Yes, you name it. They paid my way there to talk about instructional design. It's kind of unbelievable. I hear that my message is so simple, and yet I got a free ride all over this world, Japan. Australia, just you know, Canada, and every state in the Union except Alaska.
Super. Yeah. That's great.
Yeah, so, and of course there were people from all of those that were teaching that way in those days.
Very nice.
Out through the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, and I retired in 84, but the there was an organization, I think I mentioned this before, and that organization, which started out as the International Society for Audio Tutorial Instruction,
uh-huh.
It has become now an international society for exploring, teaching, and learning, and just a couple of years ago, they asked me to come back and give their keynote address, and that was in Florida. And it meets in October each year.
Sure. Yeah, well, that's very nice.
Yeah. So, you know, they have given me many awards from time to time.
Like, want to name a couple?
I'm not sure about the exact names, actually. I've got one on my wall in there. They call me the grandfather of technology, technological instruction out here. They used to call me an innovator,
Well, that's appropriate.
I used to go to meeting after meeting after meeting, and if there was any place that I really wanted to go for some reason, I could contact somebody there. They would pay my way so I could.
I'll be there, right? There.
Yeah.
I'm on the way.
That was a nice era for me.
Nothing problem about that. Sounds good to me. We got Sigma Chi gave you the Best Teacher Award in '65, and you got the Oakland Community College. Tell us about the Samuel Postlethwait Award, your patron.
Well, the Oakland Community College wanted to do their total instruction by audio tutorial, and so it was a brand new college, and they were just starting. And so I worked with them, trying to teach them the same thing I just said to you.
Sure.
It is difficult for some teachers to accept this perspective of instructional design because of the curve concept, and so many people think that you have to have so many failures and you have to have so many A's, and that you couldn't have all the people knowing botany, you know. And so this was difficult for them, and I don't think that it lasted as a total use of audio tutorial, but I think that some of the teachers kept with audio tutorial over several years, and then as computers came along, they moved on
to
their own instructional design. But also, I never wanted anybody to do just what I did. I think that every teacher has to be an independent thinking person, and a teacher ought to be a creative person who thinks through their own instructional design here, and again, be a facilitator of the student's growth and all of the student's growth with whom they deal.
Let me ask you, Lenny Community College, were the students, were these older students, do you think? You said this was new when it got started, so maybe they were younger, but oftentimes a lot of the community colleges have older students who are working, have been out of school for a while and are coming back, or at the time that you were involved, they were more older than maybe the Purdue students were.
Right. Okay. But I don't think that was a major factor.
It's just that the student body composition was different than what we had, say, at Purdue that you had.
And there was another school, too, in Colorado, Colorado Mountain College, that they, when in their initial development, they designed their facilities around this. But I'm sure that as people grew, if I were teaching, I would not just be using a tape recorder. I would be using a computer now. And so it properly, I think, is no longer the way people teach. However, in some areas, like some of the foreign countries, this would be an excellent way of providing them with some instruction without without much expense.
Right, exactly.
And tape recorders now are. And you know that after this, during the late 60s and 70s, then they begin to do a lot of children's books with tape readings for them. And in fact, prior to those children's books were out, I used to do this for my granddaughter who lived in Brazil, and not Brazil, Indiana, in Brazil.
South America.
And so I would take a book and read to her and call her by name and say, yeah, now Megan, turn the next page, you know, and so she would sip it. And one time we visited her in Brazil, and she would get up on my lap and get the tape recorder, and she would play the tape recorder even though I was there.
She wanted to be close to you while she could.
But there were many, many books and kids programs, and there was a Joe Novak. I think I mentioned him the last time you were here, who was at Cornell, and he did a lot of research work, good research work on the use of this.
Sure.
And discovered that even the placement of the various subjects during a tutoring process, that the location of those before the kids was a consequence in success of the students.
Yeah. One thing on teaching machines, just a clarification for researchers, this is very different.
Yes.
Sometimes people that jump out, so that was completely different.
And yes, but it also was long about that time that, and there were several innovators, if you please, all across the world, but the ones I knew were here in the United States, and they had their various slants on how to do this, and eventually all of them became a part of this society here, and it became the first change was International Society for Individualized Learning. We put a lot of emphasis on learning and used the term learning a lot because the word teaching at that time, and I don't know how it is now, but that get kind of was a delivery sort of
sure.
perception, whereas learning was a...
What you were trying to do when that got the message.
Trying to get the student to do something.
Right, yeah.
Because learning must be done by the learner.
That's right, exactly.
Yeah.
On that, back to that Oakland, do they still have that Postlethwait Award, do you know, up there or not?
I don't know.
Okay.
They established it initially,
and I
don't know how long it lasted. Actually, the Botanical Society of America they have various sections, and the teaching section established a Postlethwait Award as well. And they also had a Bessie Award for teachers, and I was the first recipient of their Bessie Award. But then they had this Postlethwait Award, which they was a yearly thing. I'm curious. I should have checked it. I haven't.
Yeah. What is that Bessie Award? Who was the sponsor of that one?
And that was the Botanical Society.
Oh, I see. Okay. All right. And then you did win the Helping Students Learn Award from the Alumni Association.
Well, yes.
Isn't that nice?
In fact, I helped organize that award, not when I received it, but when that
nice
came
award.
Along, early on, there was a committee of us that put that together, and so I was
You're on the organizing committee, right?
Helping students learn.
Sure.
Award.
Right.
Because of what we've just been saying.
Right, exactly.
That,
and it still goes. It's
yeah,
still going on.
Yeah. That was a nice award.
Yeah.
But I got other awards from students and some of the, I guess, fraternities and some of the co-ops, I think.
How about, what's that, International Society for Exploring Teachers' Alternatives? You got a Distinguished Fellow Award.
Well, yes.
That's
yes,
very nice.
Yeah.
How did you hear about that?
Well, you happen to know,
yeah,
know about that.
Yeah, did they contact you, or?
Yeah, to make sure that I was, was there, yeah.
Why do you want to know? Well, we might take you out for dinner or something.
Yeah.
It's kind of hard to get around those things,
yeah,
I think. Then you served under Dr. Hansen and Dr. Hubby, didn't you?
Yes.
Over there.
Yes.
And
yes.
Dr. Baring was coming on board when you retired.
Yes.
Just here. So we got. Did you interact any time with either Hansen, Dr. Hansen, or Dr. Hubby?
Not a whole lot,
okay,
because there was nothing really that I needed to,
sure,
you know, we had a good relationship,
sure,
and,
oh, yeah, right,
and we visited, and they were very generous in their, you know, when they talked about me, they were very generous about it, and even Jiske was very, very generous about it.
Did you touch base with him, Dr. Jiske?
Yes, a time or two.
Good.
There was somebody, I think, one of my past students, and I think it was in New York, that he had talked with that student about making some sort of a contribution to the university. And the student then had mentioned something about my teaching. And so very often when he was making a talk about teaching, why he wouldn't mention this incident.
Very nice. Well, see, that's nice. Yeah. And that teaching, any tidbits, or you'll enjoy teaching? It's a learning.
That was my life.
Right.
And that's just what I did. Of course, that's how I started out life. And I think I mentioned earlier what an impact Hickory Knob had on my
life.
Which, again, was the helping students learn perception rather than the delivering information perception of what the task is.
Sure, that's right. And do you still keep in touch with some of them, though? You said you keep in touch from time to time.
Oh.
They come on campus, any of the students?
Oh, yes. I have a graduate student that was here early on in the audio tutorial development, and he was my graduate student, and he has retired, and he has a son that has a $500,000 printer, and he does fundraising by printing note cards and postcards. And so a year ago, this past Christmas, he was moving to town, and he stopped by to visit. He saw some of my pictures, and he said, well, I could use some of these in our note cards. So he started using those. And so then he said, boy, why don't you go down town and take some pictures of town? So I did. And so he made note cards of town and then made note cards of Purdue. And we have several note cards of Purdue. And these are available here in town now. But this is just in this last couple of years.
Uh-huh.
And then we did bridges of Park County, but this summer, in early July, he decided that we would go, and did I tell you this?
A little bit about it, yes, you've been doing some things here with him.
Yeah,
off the record, what you did afterwards, and that's nice,
yeah,
so that brings in what you're doing in retirement, which is...
Yeah, and so that's what I was doing when I hurt my hand.
Right, okay. Oh, dear.
We're doing the cities of Indiana.
Okay, and you're visiting him. And he may do a book.
We're working on the book
right
now. That
would be very nice.
Yeah.
get a little bit of publicity on it. That would be great. What are the things you've been doing in your retirement activities?
Well,
share some of those.
Nature Center is right nearby. So it's a real pleasure for me to make little instructional programs, not necessarily audio tutorial programs, but during the past couple of years or so, 3 years, we've had some easels, and on those easels we put pictures of various things around the bog, and this has been such a pleasure for me to be right here, and I have.
Do you give programs as well?
And some, mm-hmm. Yes. We did one this spring on what you watch the woods awaken. There weren't very many people coming to do that, but we did that, and did a photography, photographing nature for kids program last year.
Oh,
and so a few things like that.
That's very
good. Occasionally, one of the schools may ask me to come and talk about plants to their kids, you know, in the first or third grade or fourth grade or fifth
very
grade.
Very nice.
And the elementary grades.
Yeah. I would have enjoyed that. how about an outstanding event in your life? Think of any outstanding event? And I also like to ask, what are one of your longest memories of Purdue, if you've got something that you'd like to share with us?
An outstanding event in my life. I would guess that it's part of my faith, and also my wife, which is such an important dimension to the whole of my life. I don't know. I was on a full ride in Australia. That was a great experience.
Was that a whole semester?
Let's see, how long did that last? That was a semester. And then I was my first time for sabbatical in England. I spent a semester in England with Professor Wardlaw there doing research and also looking at instructional. This is before audio tutorial, but that was a great experience for me.
This allowed you to do some, what you said earlier, allowed you to do some traveling. You traveled extensively on this audit with your audit tutorial.
Oh, yes.
During invitations and things, and that really was a global thing.
Well, you don't have time to listen to all of those. Because I spent a couple of weeks in South Africa with one of the vice chancellor there came and to observe audio tutorial.
Came here to Purdue?
Came here to Purdue, and he wanted me then to come to South Africa and talk to their faculty. And so I did that, and he took us around through the Kruger Park, and they treated me like I was somebody.
Well, sure you were. They were glad to have you there.
And it was
right on the front line.
Those were such great times for me,
That's good.
And
great opportunities.
Such a great bunch of good people and good teachers that were in the 60s and 70s that I was rubbing shoulders with, and we each were helping each other, and again, audio tutorial was a nothing without the students and their help and the graduate students and their help. They're the people that constantly, I think I told you that 32 of them,
right,
ate around that every week.
That made it.
And so they really contributed more than I did. I just kind of sat and...
The team.
Yeah, we had that. For about 5 years, we had interns here. The Johnson Foundation and the Lilly Foundation supported people to come, teachers to come. And at one time, I had 12 interns here working to... And they, too, their job was to do something to make my course better. That was one of the things that they had to do. And their other job was to report on other innovations and instructional designs in this world here. And the consequence of this was that at the end of 1 year, they decided to write a book, and that's the book that they wrote, Exploring Teaching Alternatives, and that was then adopted as a part of the Audio Tutorial Society derived society.
Right.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah. Yeah.
That worked out nicely.
And so so we had national support. And opportunity, you know, went to Germany and
it was wonderful sharing that with all the students and the teachers.
The people were so nice. The people were so nice. And the surprising thing is that this is such a simple way of looking at what our job is as a teacher. And that so many people, of course, we all grew up with back in the days, you'd have to be as old as I am to realize that a teacher was the source of content, the source of everything, right. And that we really hadn't thought about a human being able to live, to think for themselves and to be interested in their own growth.
And add to it.
Well, you know, so much of the time we talk to even, you know, with kids, you say, well, how's school today? Did you get a whipping for something? And, you know, as if school was a punishment. And so many grew to think of school as punishment instead of a tremendous opportunity for personal development.
Right.
Here. And to turn... To try to turn this around was really my life.
Yeah. Any questions that you'd like to ask that were not asked, and think of anything else?
Oh, I think I've told you more than I know.
Oh, I think it's been... anything else? But the enrichment, and you can look back on the enrichment that you brought into the students and the teachers who are working with
and them. The enrichment that they brought to my life.
So it was a two-way. It's a two-way thing. You learn from your students, and your students learn from you.
Yeah, and well, also Midwest. I don't mean to put down other areas of the country, but Midwest people and people with farm background perceive this world a little differently than people who have an artificial, man-made background, you know, with stoplights and things. I had this, I told you about this group of interns. They did a bit of research on my, I had 800 students at this time, so they did some research in which they used, there was a fellow by the name of Piaget, a French researcher that developed a program for determining ability to solve problems. And so we use this test on my students, and my prediction was that those students who had farm connections would be better able to solve problems than people who didn't have farm connections. Now, and the reason I believe this, believe that, was because on a farm, you run into problems and you don't have a solution to that. You have to figure out a solution to it.
Sure.
Most of us who live not on a farm now, the solutions are already there. We just have to implement them. And so indeed, there was a significant difference in ability to solve problems. Again, it's a simple thing. Practice makes you better at whatever you do. And so if in the early stages of your life, you're exposed to situations where you have to solve problems, you're much better able and have more practice in solving problems when you're older. I mean,
and also sometimes what will come into play is discussions in the solving, say, on the farm with the parents.
Yes, exactly.
And so you get, and when you come, you can work within a group.
Yes.
And it's a sharing,
This
might be the way to go with it.
Well, and see, I'm convinced that it's much easier to learn if you know what the problem is or the question is than memorize answers for questions. Memorize answers for which you have no questions. And if you memorize answers for which you have no questions. And so the underlying design of all my instruction was to identify the problem first, or the question first. Then you look for sources of information that relate or don't relate, and you try, and so relating what you find that, and determining that which really relates to the problem, was a part of experience I've tried to give all my students here. And then you come to a conclusion about that. So every week, all of my students had that to do. They had that to do in an oral situation. They had that to do in a general assembly situation. We called it a general assembly because it was not a lecture necessarily. It could be a lecture, but whatever happened there, the students, at the end, the last 20 minutes of each of that assembly session.
That was the one big session?
Uh-huh. Yeah, and they would have to write a summary of what happened there. And the first thing they had to do in their summary was identify the question, the basic theme or the basic question being addressed. And secondly, they would have to say, well, what were the sources of information that were brought to bear on that? And then they would summarize, what do you now know? And then the last thing in that was, how does this relate to your life specifically? How does this relate to your life specifically? Well, can you imagine 800 students and somebody said, well, won't they cheat? Yeah, and then that last 21, I hope they do. I hope they ask, what was the major issue being addressed here? And they had to write it as a question. And I hope they were paying attention and observing whether or not there was adequate source of information. Now, one student writes his heart. He wrote, I believe this is so because Sam said so, and Sam doesn't lie.
But one time evaluations are always the best thing. Yeah.
But every, can you imagine that every week, every student had to write a summary here in that format in which they were looking for the question and looking for the sources of information and saying, and this is what I now know about that, and this is how it relates to me. Well, the question And of course, well, how do you grade that? Well, one of the problems was with my graduate students, I had to have graduate students help me because there are 800, you know, to do this. They would say, well, Sam, what is the major? It's your question. And I'm saying to them, one of the things that brings about progress in this world is that some people see a body of information in a different perspective than others, and they see a different question. Mm-hmm. And when they do that, they now make real progress. And so whatever the student thought the question was, that's right. That's correct. So give them 1 point for that. That's correct. Now, the next thing that is of concern to me is, did their answer and their summary, what they wrote, relate to to that question? Because there's lots of information that doesn't relate to a question, and you're exposed to lots and lots of information that doesn't relate to a question. And sorting that out is very, very important. And in fact, some of the students in the early stages, the first 2 or 3 weeks, they would try to inundate us with content that they heard. And we would say, oh no, don't want all that content. Want just that which relates to the question. You said this was a question. Okay, what do you now know about that question here? And so what I was trying to, again, I believe that practice makes you better. You'd be a better golfer if you practice. And I believe that you're, and so in a sense, you see, this was a problem-solving weekly thing that every student encountered here. And now my colleagues and my graduate students had problems, with grading. I said, the only thing you have to be critique here, and then also see that they were sincere about how they think that relates to their. And if they're sincere about that, that's another point. So they got 3 points.
Good learning thing. That's a challenge too.
Yeah, but you see, on a weekly basis, for 800 students, this was a challenge, and we had fun though. They needed to, in another setting, to write look for an analogous, something analogous to a thing like mitosis here. And so some would talk about the separation of chromosomes during mitosis as being divorced, or whatever. We made this a contest to have the best analogy. I hear the best student analogy, and so my graduate students would, at the end of each week, would look at the analogies that the students wrote, and then we would give an award, which at the beginning of the next General Assembly session, and it was usually a bottle of Coke or something like that, not a big thing. But for the student who won that week, they ran down there to get whatever this was.
Let's make a deal, right?
But it was...
Good challenge.
But in the meantime, they were looking that whatever the phenomenon was, they were looking in their lives for something that...
Analogous to that. Sure. Right.
Sometimes their analogies were pretty, but that of course gave graduate students some problems because they thought everything ought to be perfect, and I don't know anybody that's perfect, and I certainly wasn't one myself, and so
anything else? That concludes the interview. Thank you very, very much.